Welcome everyone, also for the people coming in. My name is Gijs Mulders. I'm a postdoctoral researcher at the University of Arizona. And today I want to talk to you about the exoplanet populations that have been discovered by the Kepler Space Telescope, how these exoplanet populations change your idea of what typical planetary systems look like, and how they have sort of forced us to rethink how planets form and what it might imply for the composition of planets and that we can observe around other stars. So I'm not doing this work in isolation. I'm working as part of the EOS team, the Earths and Other Solar Systems team, led by Daniel Appai, who's the PI of this project. It's a project funded by NASA Nexus. And basically, the overarching goal of this project is to follow basically the evolution of how organics are sort of from the molecular cloud scale. We want to trace them through the protoplanetary disk scale, eventually into exoplanets. So I'm working basically in this large part, like how are organics, and in particular water, delivered to planetary systems. So the Kepler Space Telescope, so for those of you not too familiar, the Kepler Space Telescope has looked for transiting exoplanets, so passing in front of their host stars, and has found an astonishing variety of exoplanets. So it's identified over 1,000 planets, more than a few thousand planet candidates, and the main thing it measures is the planet's orbital period and their planet radii. So this plot shows the radius of the planet as a function of their orbital period. And if you put this in these planets in the context of the planets in the solar system, you see that it's quite a different population. So here are the terrestrial planets in our solar system, which are a little bit smaller and a little bit further out than this new population that is discovered. And for reference, Jupiter and Neptune are plotted on this scale. So what we see is we have this planet population here with a typical orbital period of about 10 or 20 days and a size like slightly smaller than Neptune and down to sort of Earth sizes. And the large question is, how do these type of planetary systems form, and how different is this from what we find in the solar system? So some of the planets that are near in the habitable zones, or planet candidates that are in the habitable zones of their stars, they don't all form around sun-like stars. So we find a lot of We find a lot of planet candidates also around different types of stars. So not just around sun-like stars, but also lower mass K stars and lower mass M stars. So there is a bit of detection bias here because it's easier to detect small planets in the habitable zone because the habitable zones are closer in and these stars are a little bit smaller. But this also reflects some of the underlying population statistics of these type of planets. If you do the calculation and try to correct for detection biases, you find that about one or one in four, about one in six M stars, they have sort of Earth-sized planets in the habitable zone. And of course, there are much more M stars in the solar neighborhood and in the galaxy than G-type stars. So this might be the prime location to look for terrestrial-sized planets in the habitable zone. And we're focusing on M stars also because they sort of illustrate some of the new planet formation mechanisms that we think are that we need to sort of explain the population of exoplanets from Kepler. So if we think of the Earth, it's relatively dry. Like it has only less than a percent of water, like 0.1% or so. But there are different possibilities for what type of planets you may form. So in particular, for low mass M-dwarfs, people have done simulations in the past where they showed, well, maybe you form planets that are much drier. They don't get delivered the same amount of water as Earth. But there's also the other possibility, sort of the extreme end, where you form planets that are much more water rich, and you have to think really of like something like 50% water. So this is also a possibility that may form. And with all these new exoplanets we discovered, like there might be a diversity. We see that there's a large diversity in exoplanetary systems, and there might also be a diversity in sort of the composition of planets that that we can observe. And the interesting thing about planets or exoplanets around these low mass M dwarfs is that they're not really scaled down versions of planetary systems around sun-like stars. There seem to be more planets around these low mass M stars than there are around more sun-like stars. This is quite surprising, but there's a number of studies. So for this figure, I've compiled different estimates of sort of the number of planets per star as a function of effective temperature. So that's a proxy for stellar mass. So you see that around these low mass M stars, you have on average about one or one and a half planets per star. And that's just at very short orbital periods. And as for these more sun-like stars, you have fewer planets. So for some reason, we have more planets at orbital periods of about less than 50 days or so around these low-mass stars. And this indicates there's something different about the planet formation mechanism that we really want to understand. So if you put this in context of sort of our previous planet formation theories and also of sort of the dust masses of protoplanetary disks that Ilaria will talk about later in this session, we see that the amount of dust in protoplanetary disks sort of increases with the mass of the star, and previously it's matched very well with the giant planets that we find. More massive stars, you find more giant planets. But for these lower mass stars, we see that this doesn't really hold. Like, we find a lot of material very close to the star locked in these planetary systems that we don't quite understand why this forms so efficiently. So what we're doing is we're trying to run a lot of simulations and to look at water delivery, like how do planets form, but we also want the simulations to be realistic for the type of exoplanetary system that we find. So this simulation here is just highlighting some of the simulations that we've done to look at water delivery and to see how planets here in the habitable zone acquire their water. So we're trying to scale this up to run a large number of planet formation simulations to track basically what is the composition of planets that form in these simulations, but also do the planets that we form, do they actually match the planets that we observe? So basically what I'm doing is I'm developing EPOS, which is the Exoplanet Population Observation Simulator. And what the simulator is doing is it basically takes the exoplanet population that you form in your simulations and you compare it to what you would observe with, for example, the Kepler Space Telescope. So this is your intrinsic population of planets. So it's, again, planet radius versus orbital period. And then the next step is to take into account the detection efficiency of the Kepler Space Telescope. So you have this detection contours where you detect most of the planets that are sort of large and close to the star. But if you go further out, so if you go to smaller planets, planets that are also smaller, your detection efficiency drops by a large factor. So if you do a Monte Carlo simulation and you basically have this intrinsic population, you have your detection efficiency, and you fold those together, you end up with something that looks a little bit like the observed distribution. So you see here there's now fewer planets in this synthetic observation and then there were in the previous sort of the full simulation. And now we can compare this sort of synthetic simulation from our models to the observed population and see how well we are doing and reproducing these observations. So that's basically shown here. So this is the synthetic population. This is the observed population, and we're simply comparing those. So this shows the cumulative distribution function in orbital periods and also in planet radius. And these are actually not the full planet formation models. They're sort of parametric distribution that we use to test this code. But you can already see that with a sort of simple functions, you can get very good constraints on this planet population. You can get a very good match. So the next step is that we take our planet formation models and we do the same thing. So we generate a lot of planetary systems. We see, okay, which ones look like the ones we observe, and then we try to sort of reproduce this population. So if you look at this plot very carefully, you see that we don't reproduce planets in all regions of parameter space yet. This is an initial run of simulation, so we're still trying to expand our models to include that. But in this very small region here that we have, we get a reasonable match with the observable. So it's sort of a good starting point sort of to expand our planet formation models. So we think like when we have compositions for all of these planets, so we can so we know these are the type of planets we actually observe. We know what their intrinsic frequency is, so we can get some estimates of how did these planets accrete and what their composition might be. Just for reference, I'm also showing you a different set of models. So these are models where so these were in situ formation models. So basically, you form your planets where you have your material as well. But as I talked about before, there might be some large-scale migration going on, especially around these low-mass stars, because we see so many planets close to these stars that we think there's an additional mechanism that's going on. And a lot of people are thinking that planet migration is one of the factors, is one of the mechanisms that explains these population. And planet migration would produce a lot more icy planets, simply because the planets form further out and then migrate into their current locations. So what you see here is the outcome of some of these planet migration models. And as you can see, like, they don't produce certain regions of parameter space very well. This is in the initial run, so we're still working on trying to improve those simulations. In terms of planet radius distribution, they're not doing so bad. So they reproduce roughly the right amount of planets. But the main problem is basically, where do your planets stop migrating? If your planets come in and they just continue to migrate, they fall into the star. So you have to stop them somewhere, which gives you a bunch of planets that are very localized, basically where they stop migrating, which is not quite what we observe yet. So this is something that we still have to work on improving those models to make sure that those models that include planet migration and predict very different compositions of planetary systems will actually match what we observe. And with that, I'm sort of coming to the end of my talk. So I would like to say that sort of constraining planet formation models is something we want to do, sort of taking into account the exoplanet population that we observed. We think that M-dwarf planetary systems, we see that the planetary systems are quite a bit different than those around Sun-like stars. So they're not simply scaled-down versions, but we think there are additional planet formation mechanisms in play that may alter the composition of the type of planets that may form. And in particular, if migration of planets plays an important role in forming these planets, then we might expect them to have a very different composition than if they form sort of more localized in the disk, which is still another possibility that remains open. So what we're doing is we're building this database of planetary systems where we have both the formation histories, and we want to see like how well do these planetary systems match the observed populations, and then try to make predictions for what are the compositions of these planets. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you. So we have about 2-3 minutes for questions. If you have a question, please step up to the mic.
Good. Hi. Good talk, guys. In your simulations with your simulated data to compare with the exoplanet observations, did you also calculate the occurrence rates from your model simulations to compare with the observed occurrence rate?
So the idea is to match the planet populations to the observed population. So we're not doing an occurrence rate calculation and then trying to explain that population, but we're doing sort of a forward modeling. So we do tune how many planets per star we have. So if our planet formation models predict too many planets or too few planets, we can adjust that in the fitting procedure. So we do get an estimate of what is the underlying number of planets per star, which is usually higher than what you would infer from an occurrence rate calculation, because there are planets in simulation you don't observe.
Yeah, thanks.
So there's also a great diversity in the protoplanetary disks that form the planetary systems. Can you tell us a bit more about the disk assumptions you've made in the model? Like, what kind of disk parameters would you be using, and how much does that influence your final calculation?
Sure. So I would also like to refer you to the talk from Ilaria Pascucci later, who will talk about basically deriving how to derive those disk masses. So you're right, there's a lot of diversity. So the plot I showed with solid mass is a function of stellar mass, or so dust mass function of stellar mass. There is a large intrinsic scatter around that relation. And there are some, there's a conversion from the flux you observe to the dust mass, which also introduces some systematic uncertainty. But we have some ideas, we have good ideas of how large those uncertainties are, and we think the scaling relation with stellar mass is very robust, even though there is some uncertainty that was also reflected in the plot.
Okay, thanks.
One more question.
Hey, so one thing that I thought maybe is missing is scattering after you form the simulations. Did you consider that? It might obviously change the occurrence rate you have, and there's evidence that perhaps there's been some of this scattering for the M-dwarfs. So I wonder if you thought about that and how maybe that might affect the results you've gotten so far.
So do you mean
like
scattering?
Like the ejection of planets, like instability, global instability in the system, sorry.
Yeah. So we don't run our planet and body simulations like for billions of years, so we don't capture that scattering quite well. So we assume that what forms is sort of what we observe. There might indeed be an additional scattering phase. I'm not sure how that would affect this on the population level, but it would be interesting to see if that significantly modifies the populations that we form, and if you can constrain that from these exoplanet populations.
Okay, thanks.
One more question? Okay, I think we should move on to the next speaker. Thank you.